Okay, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this afternoon's thought leadership session. My name is Paul Bennett, and I'm the project manager for NG-CDI. So our speaker today is Dr. Charalampos Rotsos, who's a lecturer in computer networks and network systems at Lancaster University. And Harris's research focuses in network service management and orchestration, network programmability and monitoring, and cloud operating systems. And today's thought leadership session is around intent-driven network testing and monitoring. And we'll cover defining services using business intent, so i.e. what we need the service to achieve, rather than using complex technical descriptions, which helps transform the relationship with BT customers and the agility at which that service is delivered. Autonomic management then allows self-learning techniques to continuously monitor and maintain SLAs in life. And these imply that pre-testing configurations and subsequent monitoring of performance are integral parts of how we define a service. And Harris is going to describe techniques and tool sets which address these stages of intent delivery, enabling BT to transform its ability to move from customer intent to operational and reliable service. So at this point, I'd like to welcome Harris to take over and to start today's session. Harris.
Yep. Thank you very much, Paul, for the great introduction, given also the situation. Hello, everybody. Welcome to the third talk on this thought leadership series. My name is Charalampos Rotsos, and together with Professor Ning Wang, we lead the efforts on intent within the NG-CDI project. And today I'm going to discuss some of the efforts, the research efforts that we have put towards exploring intents and how they can be applied in terms of network testing and network monitoring. So for today's talk, I will kick off a bit with a brief introduction to intent-based networking. We already have delivered a couple of talks on the topic, so I'm just doing a bit of a refresher effectively. And then I'm going to move into some of the challenges that we have identified in the adoption of IBN while interacting with different BT stakeholders. Motivated by these challenges, we're going to discuss how techniques of network testing and monitoring can address some of these challenges, and focus specifically on three systems that explore how we can perform integration and system testing for networks, how we can do performance testing for VNFs, and finally, how we can make service-oriented monitoring for systems using intent policies. For our brief introduction into intent-based networking, so a lot of you, as you hopefully are aware, one of the key elements to drive modern network infrastructures and get the added value services that you want is effectively network configuration, right? So effectively, this is the secret sauce that makes all this equipment to perform what you actually want and also deliver the services required by the users. So network configuration has become a very key element in operating network systems, and it's becoming nowadays also a major bottleneck on actually fulfilling user requirements. Traditionally and historically, network configuration was driven primarily by network administrators. So effectively, a network administrator would be responsible to collect requirements from users and then sit on their desk and decide how, by reconfiguring devices, they will be able to meet the requirement of the user. So effectively, the translation layer here, the translation mechanism was the network administrator, who would then go sit on their terminal and type in all the configuration changes required to deliver these services. Now, as you can imagine, this becomes a bottleneck, and effectively, the human involvement slows down the process of actually changing the network and making it to respond to user requirements. So, and especially with the recent growth that we have in network infrastructures and the use of networks. So in recent years, efforts have emerged trying to see how we can make this process less human-centric and how we can automate it. original efforts tried to use policy mechanisms built into the configuration systems to meet this requirement. So effectively, the idea is that the configuration interface would have statements and keywords that would allow the user to offload some of the adaptation that was required by the network into the device itself, and the devices would be able to monitor the condition of the network and update their configuration on their own. Nonetheless, the scope of these changes would be rather small, and it would be focused on specific device-specific aspects. So the human, again, was a key element, and still it was this human involvement was still the bottleneck. An alternative approach that has emerged in recent years, driven also a lot by the extensions and the progress we have with AI ML models, is intent-based networking. And the basic idea of intent-based networking is tries to decouple the actual configuration of the network from the actual requirements that we have from the network. IBNs effectively, they define high-level data models through which both users as well as network administrators can describe the requirements, and then intelligent systems can generate from this and the condition of the network the right configuration that can make the system to deliver these intents effectively. Now, one of the great benefits of IBN also is that because they perform this decoupling operation, they have the ability to also perform the ongoing reoptimization of the configuration to meet the user requirement, which is effectively, it removes a lot the requirement for humans to drive these changes. So just to give you some ideas of how these intents would look like. So in an intent, we can have expressions of what type of actions we can provide. This can be operated on specific objects, and we can define things like what limits we can have and certain conditions also. So they usually have this type of architecture. And also the other interesting thing is that, you know, intent systems, you usually would create different intent frameworks targeting different users and consumers effectively, and you can create intents that they can both fulfill requirements for network engineers, for stakeholders within the operator, but they can also be exposed to end users to define their functional requirements. Now, in the last 1 year and a half, we started having our first prototypes that delivered some basic intents. And one of the key drives also for the NG-CDI project is trying to explore a type of intent, which would a set of intents that they would fulfill the requirements of business processes within BT. And, you know, when we started building our first prototypes and systems, we started engaging with network engineers, network designers within BT, and try to collect use cases and scenarios which we would be able to integrate with our system to demonstrate some of our work and how it can improve things within the company. And in our interactions, we identified that there was a bit of hesitancy. And we identified that effectively we had a phenomenon which I think they call it automation anxiety. So people were a bit hesitant of adopting automation and IBM systems for three main reasons. So the first thing is that there is increased stress when you delegate tasks to an automation system of whether the automation system would deliver what you would expect. And that's because on the one hand, your AI ML model, you know, although they yield good results and they have evolved in the recent years, sometimes also they don't give what you expect as a result. The other also situation is that, you know, these systems, if you don't design them correctly, it is possible to end up in situations where basically there is an error happening in the system and they have no idea how to react to it. And there is an increased fear that, you know, if I adopt some of these approaches, it will end up being another system that I have to monitor rather than giving me the ability and the flexibility to focus on something which is more productive and creative. The other aspect that was also that we saw that was causing this anxiety was the modeling aspect and the fact that modern networks are becoming increasingly complex. They consist of multiple layers, and modeling all this stuff is rather challenging. And it's not always straightforward to say I have an abstraction and now I can apply this abstraction to this new system and define all the parameters in my system. And there is always the question of when I do this translation, what's the right value for feature A, B, or C? And the final thing which also emerged is that currently a lot of the monitoring systems, they are suitable at detecting errors and problems in the system, but they probably are not tailored to provide the automation visibility required in order to delegate some of the common management tasks into an automated system. And effectively, a lot of the monitoring that's currently available in networks usually builds around what's available, which then, with a bit of processing, can be analyzed to deliver what we actually require in terms of monitoring from the system. But sometimes also this monitoring information can be extremely low level, and it won't be sufficient, for example, to troubleshoot a specific problem and do some root cause analysis. So in order to address some of these challenges, we took a step back and start exploring how we can make automation and IBN a bit more, how we can create some assurances inside the process. And usually it's good to go and see how other also domains adopt this in production and try to see how they do it and what their success stories are. And effectively, we went back to cloud computing, which is a very good example of how automation can drive real change in production, right? And in cloud systems nowadays, you have this DevOps paradigm and the CI/CD pipelines, where basically you can translate code changes, you can have them in production in a matter of hours. And the key process that takes place to provide that, to establish this, and they achieve that with very low downtimes in their systems, is the fact that they are doing a multi-stage testing approach, right? So testing is present throughout the process of the delivery of a service, and it applies validation on different aspects also. So you have functional tests and non-functional tests, each of them trying to cover different aspects of the software. So our idea then was, well, can we adopt some of these testing mechanisms as part of our IBN system? And whether we can even also use our IBN system to drive some of the monitoring, so we can also enable these DevOps pipelines in the actual network system and within automation. So this had a bit of a build up. Sorry about this. I don't know why my animations don't work. So basically, this is again a bit of a high level view of our the architecture, one view of the architecture of our intents. And effectively, we in order to deliver intents in our system, we create four distinct planes or layers. So we have the user, the intent layer, the infrastructure, and our knowledge plane. And effectively, in order to process intents, we effectively define three key control loops that effectively translate high-level intents into actual system configuration. So the first control loop usually exists between the user and the intent layer. And in previous talks, we have discussed how we actually enable this. And at this stage, effectively, the user and the intent system negotiate the parameters of an intent. Once this is finalized, the intent is being pushed to the next stage, where basically our intent layer, using information from our knowledge plane as well as AI ML models, it translates and plans the delivery of this intent into the actual infrastructure. Then our intent layer, using open APIs from the underlying infrastructure, can effectively deploy what we have planned for our intent into the actual infrastructure. And then using the built-in monitor of the infrastructure, can receive back feedback on what has been deployed and how the deployment of the intent looks like in our system. And develop a second control loop, where basically this monitoring information is being constantly validated. And if a specific intent is not valid, a replanning stage is being initiated to redeploy the service in order to fulfill again our intent. The monitoring information also can be processed by an analysis stage within the intent layer, which then can provide high-level reports back to the user to give greater visibility on the automation. So this here is the basic pipeline, which we have shown in the past, and it's driven also a bit by some standardization efforts from the IETF. So our idea effectively is trying to figure out how we can embed additional stages in this process to effectively enable all these testing and monitoring mechanisms that they would improve the assurance on the automation. So for the remainder of this presentation, I'm going to discuss three systems that we have been developing, delivering different types of tests. So we have NEAT, which provides integration testing for network configuration. We have built Wayfinder, which is a performance testing tool for VNFs that tries effectively to tune different parameters on a VNF. And we also have been exploring how we can improve monitoring for intents, and how we can have intent-centric monitoring in our system, in our infrastructures when we run an intent. And we will be discussing later about a system called Uniprobe that tries to deliver that. So for our first system, so our first question effectively is how we can verify whenever our intent layer decides about a new configuration, whether that configuration actually works or not, right? You would call this usually integration test in traditional cloud terms, right? And so unlike software, networks are a bit bespoke in the sense that whenever you deploy a new configuration, unlike code, some parts of the infrastructure are usually bespoke, specialized components, which cannot be easily replicated realistically inside in software exclusively. And the second thing is that we lack also testing mechanisms for actual configuration in the network. So this motivated us to build an automation testing platform. This is integrated with intents, and it can be driven by intents, but also it can target general everyday configuration processes in networks. And the system is called NEAT, and its main goal effectively is to be used as a mechanism where you can recreate realistically using emulation real network topologies. You can onload real configuration files from the actual running system into this virtual environment and effectively recreate realistically your actual running system, and then be able to run tests and validate whether specific functional variants are maintained by your configuration. We have been lucky because the current softwarization effort driven by a lot of vendors has given us a series of device images, which allows us to effectively use common network virtualization technologies to replicate the behavior of these systems. And effectively, you know, our system NEAT, you can define a topology that contains a wide range of different network technologies, including, you know, Docker containers, Kubernetes services. You can have KVM or Zen VMs, as well as virtual VNF images from Cisco, Junos, and Nokia. And effectively, our NEAT system can use topology, can use real software, and recreate on a single host all the different nodes of the network, load the real configuration files, and provide the required connectivity to replicate the real network. Now, for the configuration now of NEET, we have opted for a YAML-based approach. We thought that this would help a lot network engineers who are usually not that good at programming. And our goal effectively is to develop a system that would allow codeless testing. So you don't need to know any programming to actually write your tests. You can just use YAML specifications to drive some of your tests. To support that, we have we have this YAML file, which consists of two components, the topologies and the actual test that we want to run on top of topologies. For our topologies, we are using a topology API called Mininet, an open source project which is widely used, and a number of topologies exist already out there on the internet. And these topologies, these topology files, they're isolated from the actual configuration of the system. So network operators, network engineers can effectively share topologies and reuse them. And so using a specific topology, the user then can define in the block section a set of tests that they can be run on top of this system. And for these tests, again, we provide a set of prepackaged tests reflecting the common tools that a network engineer would use in the field. So things like ping, traceroute, iperf, pathload, all these kinds of tests. And effectively, the system would recreate the topology defined on the topology section and run a set of tests defined by the blocks on top of this topology and describe whether the tests were successful or not back to the user. And the system also, it's designed to run in a compartmentalized way and using Docker containers. So we can provide also strong isolation and resource control. And we can run multiple experiments in parallel on the same host. So just to give you, there was recently like a tech talk by the person who leads this effort, Will Fandom. That should be available soon on the NG-CDI project, which you're more than welcome to join. So just to give you a bit of a set of achievement that we have using NEET, right? So the first thing that we try to explore is how we can make NEET relevant to network operators. And so one thing that we try to do is we found an open source, a set of configurations and a topology for a real production network, the one that's in the Stanford, I think it's the Stanford halls. So this would have like the actual topology of the system as well as the configuration Cisco files, the source configuration files. So using NEET, we were able to recreate this topology and run a bunch of tests on top of this system. And this was part of a published paper called ATPG, and which basically explores the topic of how you can generate some of these probes to figure out problems with configuration. And we have been able to replicate their experiments and identify errors in the configuration by using our system. The second now thing that we were really interested in is try to see how we can make our system part of a CI/CD pipeline to enable what you usually call as network DevOps, right? And because we have adopted a compartmentalized approach to NEET and everything is dockerized effectively, we have the ability to run NEET as part of the default GitHub actions. And effectively, we can integrate a JIT repo with the automated testing of this JIT repo, which can then trigger subsequent deployment scenarios, for example, which is a thing that can really automate the process of rolling out the topology. And we have here also a very nice demo video if you want to learn more. Now, in terms now of the actual intent layer and how we can integrate intent into the testing, we have been exploring a specific use case, right? So here, this is a virtual network that we have built as part of NEET. It tries to resemble a bit the 21CN architecture of the BT network. And we have tried here to explore how we can provide mechanisms that can automatically detect if We have a hybrid network where we have both programmable and legacy devices, and we want to automatically test how the two work together and ensure that if something happens on the programmable side, it plays well with the legacy. So effectively, half of the topology here is built using OpenVSwitch and OpenFlow instances, while the other half uses Cisco routers configured to run BGP sessions and the right routing configuration. So in this system, let me see how I can build this up. Can I build it up from here? Sorry. Oh, there we are. Yeah. So using now an intent layer, we're able in this topology to drive some connectivity intents, right? So we effectively generate intents that would effectively allow some hosts in the network to connect with IP addresses beyond the local network by just setting up paths to connect them with the local gateway router. Now, as I said earlier, our intent layer tries also to explore how we can provide some capabilities to do business intents. And one of the intents that we support effectively provides a process called drain, where basically whenever you want to upgrade a specific hardware device, you're able effectively to drain the traffic from that device while you change a specific hardware card or you change some of the configuration. So in our intent layer now, in our use case, what we do is we effectively build in into our drain intent the capability to effectively, before actually deploying, once it has computed how it will perform the intent, before actually rolling out these changes into the real running network, it can invoke the NIT system, replicate the real hardware with the static configuration of the legacy program, and then use that to test if the actual drain operation would be compatible with all the connectivity intents in the system. And we have tested scenarios where basically one of our routers is not configured to play well with another switch, and we have been able to test that the connectivity is achieved. So the second goal in terms of the automation and the testing is trying to provide mechanisms that can automatically tune the performance of VNF systems, right? So in the softwarization process of networks, we have reaped very good results in terms of flexibility, but we have inherited also a number of challenges that they're very common on the software world. And one of these is the challenge to configure things, right? So software systems, they tend to use a lot of layers in between the different systems to be able to abstract functionalities. And typically this layering creates an explosion in the number of configuration parameters that you have. And usually a common problem for software developers is, how do I pick the right configuration parameters to make my system perform well in an environment? And these configurations, they matter a lot. So here at the bottom, we have a figure where we test all the possible values for seven parameters across the different layers of the software for a VNF consisting of an Nginx web server running on top of a Unicraft operating system, a unikernel minimal operating system. And we report here for each type of configuration what was the maximum achieved rate of requests that the system can deliver. And we identified that by just tweaking only seven parameters, we were able to improve by 33% the performance of the best configuration over the default configuration. In order to achieve that, though, we had to run 512 different experiments. And this improvement only covers seven parameters. In actual systems, these parameters could be on the order of hundreds. So this forms a very nice automation process that gives us the opportunity for a very nice performance characterization process. And to support this exploration on the configuration space, we developed a system called Wayfinder. So This is an effort led by one of our PhDs, Alex Jung, in collaboration with some colleagues in NEC and in University of Bucharest. And effectively, Wayfinder, the way it works, is it gives you an environment where you can combine, you can effectively describe an exploration space for a specific application, and the system can automatically run all the required tests and describe what's the optimal configuration parameter. Wayfinder again adopts a YAML-based approach to describe your configuration space and how it operates. And then this YAML file can be fed into a set of services, which they would build the compute all the possible permutations, build the required VMs, and then a scheduler would effectively run all these tests in a way which doesn't incur any overhearing effects between experiments, and report back the performance the system has achieved. So we also have defined some generic APIs on the different stages so that we can have different mechanisms to decide what kind of permutations, what kind of configurations we test, so we can speed up the process effectively. And you also have a pluggable system where you can your testing capabilities can play around with many different systems. So you can have, for example, an OSM orchestrator as a backend, or a Kubernetes system for as a backend. At the moment, our Wayfinder testing system has been built using the Unigraft and the it has built-in support for Unigraft and OSV systems, and we're currently exploring also we have built and we're currently exploring the space for Linux systems as well, Linux operating systems. Now, one thing probably that a lot of you would have spotted already is that, you know, this exploration stage probably takes too long to achieve. And there's probably like a benefit to make this process a bit more intelligent. You know, like the default experiment just described takes around 16 hours to achieve using just Unigraft. And if you go in the Linux domain, this probably would be months. So there are probably like our initial estimations find that 10 million experiments would be required to cover some very simple use case scenarios for Linux. So the other direction that we're currently exploring is trying to see how AI and ML mechanisms can be built on top of Wayfinder to also make a smart decision on how we choose our parameters. And, you know, like in our previous experiments, we have identified that traditional optimization, AI ML optimization mechanisms built around Bayesian optimization can retrieve the best configuration in just 30 iterations. We're currently also exploring how this can be improved by incorporating more parameters and also testing things like neural networks for this stage exploration. But also, it's interesting also to highlight that the work with Wayfinder opens up a very nice space to explore other questions. Like, for example, you know, using Wayfinder, you can effectively create models about specific VNF and their operation, and then try to see, you can possibly speed up the process of testing an application which is similar. So you can have an NG-CDI, an Nginx model, which can be used to quickly estimate the performance on Apache VNF. And similarly, also, you can create workload-based models. You can incorporate also the workload element in this performance exploration, which can be used then at runtime, and depending on the traffic conditions, to effectively select what would be the best configuration for your running VNF. And for the final system that we want to discuss today, so this is called UniProbe, and effectively we're trying to see also how we can improve the monitoring capabilities of our intent system to make it oriented around intents and effectively try to provide greater visibility on the automation processes. Effectively, our motivation for UniProbe is that currently the way that monitoring works in modern network infrastructure is that it's driven by what's available and not what's required, right? So usually a lot of the systems currently that they perform network monitoring, they would rely on low-level metrics collected by systems like SNMP or from whatever OpenStack exposes in terms of the platform metrics, for example, for a specific VM, which tends to be very low-level. Nonetheless, services in, deployed now in networks can be rather complicated, and they can consist of many layers of software, which requires specialized monitoring in order to understand what's going on in the system. So UniProbe, what it tries to do is it tries to utilize information in the intent layer to drive some of the monitoring in the system. One of the big challenges, though, when you do this specialized monitoring is you have to pay a high cost in terms of the resource required to perform this monitoring. In order to address this challenge, we also have been developing, we have coupled together with the logic of how we drive this monitoring. We have created also some specialized monitoring probes built around unikernel technologies that they can provide some unique features in terms of the resource utilization that they have in the system and the impact they have in the resource utilization on the system. So UniProbe effectively can receive, can consume intents defined by the user through our intent layer. And a mechanism can effectively plan alongside the deployment of the actual intent, a set of monitoring requirements around the deployed service. This deployment plan then can be translated into a network service descriptor. And the monitoring planner also can utilize the build system of unikernel systems to effectively create also the required images to drive this functionality. So all this can be then sent to our service orchestrator, and the service orchestrator can then deploy the service alongside the main service and monitor the performance of the service in order to readapt if something required. Our VNFs, our monitoring VNFs also have integration provide the Prometheus exporter effectively. So data from this monitoring process can be fed back into the telemetry database of the whole system, and they can be then consumed by different AI ML methods to effectively also drive some of the deployment of the main service effectively. In order to try to improve also the efficiency of this monitoring process, we also are exploring how we can use hierarchical data collection systems to effectively reduce the impact of the data collection process on the network by having localized and hierarchical data sinks for the data. And we're also exploring how some of these techniques can be also coupled with some of the anomaly detections that our colleagues in the math and stats department here in Lancaster are developing, to see how we can create monitoring probes that they can switch between high monitoring and low monitoring versions of the service whenever an anomaly is detected in the system. So just to give you an example of how UniProbe operates. So we have here an intent that defines like a CAS service that needs to be built and deployed through our CAS system. This intent can be consumed by our intent manager, and it would generate a VNF service via the service orchestrator. But then by using some of the specifications in terms of performance requirements that embedded inside the intent language, we can also feed this into the UniProbe system and generate a set of monitoring probes that they would sit alongside the main service. So for example, in order to monitor the latency of our system, we can have an HTTP probe client sitting at the entry point of our service and effectively measure how long it takes to request specific objects from our CAS service. And similarly, in order to monitor the bandwidth requirements of the system, we can also have bandwidth estimation systems using services like Pathload, for example, or YAS, and estimate for the individual paths how much available bandwidth is there. Just to give you now some more information about the benefits of this approach and how it works. So I have here also some values to show you, like the aspect of the amount of impact it has on the actual infrastructures and the resources required. So we have here a set of popular monitoring processes, FPing, Ping, WRK, and YAS. And we estimate the image size to create actually the binary that can be built and can run into the system. And we can see that, for example, building things with Unigraph can have a 10 times lower image size in comparison to a VM built using Alpine, which is a very popular lightweight Linux distro. But there is also a great benefit in terms of memory utilization. So Unigraph, for example, can spin up VNFs that perform these monitoring services and require less than 10 megabytes to operate, while the equivalent Linux system requires at least 1 to 200 megs to just boot the VM. And if we also use Ping and try to see how it compares with the VM, we would see that Unigraph is pretty close to what an Alpine VM would report in terms of latencies. And it can even perform better if we use some modified drivers. So that would be like, these are pole-based drivers built as part of the KVM virtio device. So this, for example, can even provide even better results than a VM equivalent. So just to conclude, like the discussion we had today. So as we discussed earlier, intent systems, they provide an excellent mechanism to drive automation in the network. And nonetheless, automation anxiety incurs a challenge with respect to adoption. And we have highlighted that there is a great benefit to explore how other domains like cloud computing have tried to introduce intents in the pipeline and try to see how we can effectively utilize these approaches to drive things in our system. And so things like testing, for example, can provide improved assurance in terms of automation in our system. And we have demonstrated here a couple of systems we have been building as part of our NIT system as part of our intent pipeline, namely configuration validation, VNF optimization, and intent-driven monitoring, in order to be able to run intents in a way which provides some strong guarantees on how the system actually operates. If you want to find out more for our project, a lot of the code is available in our GitHub repo, which is at github.com/ngcdi. And also some of these systems, also we have demo videos which you can find on the NG-CDI website.